So faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
For you have delivered my soul from death, yes, my feet from falling. When I am afraid, in God whose word I praise, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid. In God whose word I praise,
in the Lord whose word I praise,
in God I trust, I shall not be afraid.
Glory
be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. For you have delivered my soul from death, yes, my feet from falling. Lord, have mercy on us.
Thank you.
So let us pray. Almighty and everlasting Father, you give your children many blessings, even though we are undeserving. In every trial and temptation, grant us steadfast confidence in your loving kindness and mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Our Old Testament reading this morning is from Isaiah chapter 56, verses 1 and 6 through 8. Thus says the Lord, keep justice and do righteousness, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord and to be his servants, everyone who keeps the Sabbath and does not profane it and holds fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. The Lord God who gathers the outcasts of Israel declares, I will gather yet others to him besides those already gathered. This is the word of the Lord. Our gradual is from Psalm 34. Fear the Lord, you and his saints. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Our epistle reading is from Romans chapter 11. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means, for I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people, whom he foreknew. Now I am speaking to you Gentiles, inasmuch then as I am an apostle to the Gentiles, I magnify my ministry in order somehow to make my fellow Jews jealous and thus save some of them. For if their rejection means reconciliation of the world, what will their acceptance mean but life from the dead? As regards the gospel, they are enemies of God for your sake, but as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers. For the gifts of the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were at one time disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, so they too have now been disobedient in order that by the mercy shown to you, they also may now receive mercy. For God has consigned all to disobedience, that he may have mercy on all. This is the word of the Lord.
Hallelujah. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the outcast of Israel. He leads the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. Hallelujah. Our holy gospel is from Matthew, the 15th chapter, verses 21 through 28. He writes, Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman from the region came out and was crying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, son of David. My daughter is severely oppressed by a demon. But he did not answer her a word. And his disciples came and begged him, saying,
send her away, for she is crying out after us. He answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But she came and knelt before him, saying, Lord, help me. And he answered, It is not right to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs. She said, Yes, Lord. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Then Jesus answered her, O woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire. And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the gospel of our Lord. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, through the power and the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This morning's message, I thought we'd take it from the gospel message this morning from Matthew, the 15th chapter, verses 21 through 28, and is dealing with the woman from Canaan, who was a Canaanite. Matthew and Mark both recount Jesus' travels into the territory of Syria and Phoenicia, which is Tyre and Sidon, a territory which was to be part of the promised land given to the tribe of Asher, but never was it ever conquered or taken possession of. This area was also known for its worship of Baal and Ashtoreth, which was detested by the Jews and by God. Baal, also known as the sun god, who was worshipped to enable the earth and for others in order for the crops to grow and also to have children. Baal was also worshipped as a storm god and is depicted with a lightning bolt in its hand. And it's interesting to note, also in Scripture, that Jesus says in Luke 10, and he said to them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. In Jeremiah 19:5, he records the human sacrifices were made to appease Baal, which normally was the firstborn, and usually that firstborn was sacrificed. And we see this type of thing when Jesus was born, not as a sacrifice, but as the work of Satan through King Herod. Zathras is the chief female deity and considered the moon goddess, who was worshipped as the goddess of love and war, and worship for her was noted by its sensuality, its ritual prostitution, and practices of divination and fortune-telling, which was also forbidden by God to be practiced. Jesus is out of his normal territory of ministry and in the land of Gentiles, the Canaanites, today known as Lebanon. He had recently heard of the death of his cousin John the Baptist by King Herod. So he withdrew to the seaport on the Mediterranean Sea of Sidon in Tyre. For he did not wish to be in the presence of Herod, who really wanted to meet him. Jesus wanted a little time to grieve and to rest and recoup from his ministry to the thousands who were hungry, who were sick, and who were lame, who were blind, and who were deaf, and who was also possessed by demonic spirits. Then this brings us to the point to ponder on in our belief of the supernatural and our Christian faith as Lutherans. Luther himself believed in demonic activity and possession, for in his baptismal liturgy he incorporated a statement of exorcism in the rite of holy baptism. Another point to meditate on is, if we believe our God can and does accomplish miracles in the created world, We accept the biblical stories of Jonah and Lazarus as historically true. However, if we believe God cannot or does not work this way, we may assume that these accounts to be fictional stories created by authors trying to prove some spiritual point. With that, we will look at the account as recorded for us in our gospel text about a very, very distraught mother and her daughter. While there at Tyre, a Canaanite woman comes to him pleading for mercy for her daughter, who is, as the ESV and other translations have recorded the event, as being severely oppressed by a demon. The Amplified Bible says, "My daughter is miserably and distressingly and cruelly possessed by a demon." Personally, I prefer the translation "possessed by a demon" than "oppressed by a demon." Scriptures usually translate the Greek word here, dynamizai, to be the possession, be possessed by a demon. Scriptures do not say what type or who or the name that the demon possessed in this child. Apparently it was a single demon, unlike the foreign, the legion that Jesus had also encountered in his ministry. You will also read in the notes of study Bibles that they will use also the word oppressed. The reason for this is, I believe, is that we have difficulty in comprehending that a person, let alone a Christian, could be possessed or believe in a spiritual world, Satan's or God's. But does not Jesus' ministry deal with demon possession and casting them out? Demon possession can be displayed or exhibited by great physical strength, hysterics, self-harm, seizures, convulsions, only to name just a few of their manifestations of a person being possessed by demonic forces. It's interesting to note that this mother is distraught with worry, genuinely concerned and fearful for her daughter. She continues to persist in a loud, troublously urgent manner, crying out and begging Jesus, calling out to him repeatedly, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David." There are some interesting things about this encounter with Jesus and the disciples. For one, Jesus did not want to be found. That they had traveled by 50 or 60 miles, which had been maybe a 2 or 3 day journey from the area of the northern tip of the Sea of Galilee and into the area of Tyre and Sidon on the Mediterranean coast. Now we hear a mother, a Canaanite woman, a person of disgust, a Gentile to the Jews, crying out to Jesus to have mercy on me. What does Jesus do? He ignores her and ignores her plea for mercy. Not only does she plead for mercy, but calls out to him as the Lord, the Son of David. So a question that we might ask ourselves is, how does this woman, a Canaanite, a Gentile, know about Jesus and his lineage? In Matthew chapter 4, instructs us that many people from the area of Syria came to see Jesus. While he was ministering and teaching in Galilee, Matthew 4 says, "And he went throughout all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom and healing every disease and every affliction among the people." So his fame spread throughout all Syria, and they brought him all the sick, those afflicted with various diseases and pains, those oppressed or possessed or visibly being tormented by a demon or demons, those having seizures and paralytics, and he healed them. So I believe that we can then kind of conclude that this mother, whose daughter was being tormented by a demon, had maybe heard and possibly had witnessed the accounts of people who returned from being healed of their diseases, their afflictions, and delivered from the bondage and possession of demons, and that this gave her faith to seek out the Lord Jesus and to plead for mercy. As she pleads for mercy, the disciples become impatient with her and constantly calling out to Jesus for mercy. This seems to be a recurring attitude and a point of irritation of the disciples. For we have seen them many times complaining to Jesus about the multitudes that seem to them to kind of encroach on their personal space. And so they plead with Jesus to take care of the situation and to send her away. I can only imagine the woman probably overheard the disciples' request to have Jesus to send her away. But what does she do? She comes even closer and kneels at the feet and continues to call out to him in desperation, "Lord, help me." Then we read about this encounter in the conversation which went on between the disciples and the woman. And Jesus says that he was only sent to the house of Israel. The woman then comes and kneels at his feet and pleads with him to help her. Jesus, in fact, tells her that it is not right for food intended for the children to be given to the dogs, kind of a slander term to her. But she responds to him that dogs eat the crumbs that fall to the floor from the master's table. Then Jesus says this great statement, "O woman, great is your faith." This statement of Jesus is seen as a rebuke to the disciples. For he chastised Peter for his lack of faith when he was walking on the water and began to sink. Or when they were crossing the Sea of Galilee, and when he had to rebuke the wind and the waves because of their fear. And later, they were rebuked again when they could not heal a boy who was possessed with a demon. He tells them that their lack of faith, for he says, "O ye of little faith." Then he says to them, "If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you could move mountains." The woman remained at the feet of Jesus, requesting mercy for her daughter. Jesus sees her faith and grants her request, and her daughter is delivered at that very hour. Have we knelt or prostrated ourselves at Jesus' feet? Maybe not physically, but what about spiritually? Do we follow the example of the woman and persist in our petitions, willing then to accept what the Lord will do in our cry for mercy? Do we come in faith? Now, this is not saving faith for salvation, but a faith that believes in Jesus Christ as our Lord, who desires to hear from us in our prayers, in our meditations, in our reading of his word. And we do it faithfully, trusting in him completely that he will answer our request according to his will for us. Our faith is in him to do as he desires, not what we desire. For we desire things that from the flesh and from our own selfish desires. Do not take me wrong. It is okay to ask in faith for specific things. For God wants to hear the things from our heart and our requests and petitions and needs. He wants us to worship him and adore him and to praise him in all types of circumstances, giving him thanks for what that he has already done, and by sending his son Jesus to die in our place whenever we are up or whenever we are down. We need to remain in his presence patiently and in faith. So too, we need to come to him meekly but boldly into his presence with faith and a right spirit. Otherwise, we just might hear these same words that he spoke to the Pharisees and the scribes. Recorded in Matthew 15, he says, "You hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you when he said, 'This people honors me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. In vain do they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men.'" May we ever be mindful of our condition as we come into the presence of God, that our heart and our mind are not under the influence of Satan and this world, always seeking to glorify itself. We need to ensure that when we come in the presence of God, that we come with the righteousness of Jesus, with a renewal spirit, a renewed spirit that has searched our innermost being. We pray to God in the name of Jesus, and that what we bring before him be done in accordance with his will, for whomever or whatever situation we may bring before him in our prayers. He listens. He will answer our prayers. The woman did not deliver her daughter from the demons. Jesus did. Jesus answers our prayers, not us. Today it's the same. Jesus is the righteous one that we look to for our salvation, healing, deliverance, comfort, guidance, and everyday cares and needs. For it is God the Father through Jesus who sent us the Holy Spirit, who accomplishes and performs and answers our prayers and requests. He knows our heart. He knows our mind. For he took all that we are and whatever we think we are, and he took all that to the cross in our place, so that we might have peace and comfort in knowing that we belong to him and that our citizenship is now in his kingdom. Amen. Now may the Lord our God continue to give you his peace in all that you do and all that you give witness to his glory. Amen.
We confess our faith with a Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
And let us pray. O gracious Heavenly Father, as we come before you this morning, we lift up to you those that we have concern for on our hearts, our families and friends and co-workers. So continue to look over them, Lord, in your mercy. And Lord, too, those of our congregation we lift up who are ill or sick or suffering. We lift up Carol, Marilyn, and Jack, and Judy, and Vic. Lord, in your mercy. We continue to lift up Les and Steve and Donna. Also continue to walk with Steve Carpenter's brother, circulatory problems, and Julie,
a former co-worker whose son was killed. Lord, in your mercy. Our Father, we also lift up our workers and also the good health and our government leaders, wisdom and leadership during this time. Everyone who has the virtue, the virus, every struggling with finances, the poor and the homeless. We ask that you be with Melanie and Gerald and John and Jesse and give them the hope of the resurrection. Also with Steve and Rivalry. Continue to watch over them and guide them, give them your peace. In your name, and we pray. So in your name, we pray. And Lord, in your mercy. We also ask you those struggling due to the hurricane on the East Coast and other areas that are. Continue to watch over us and guide us in all that we do. Be with those who are in the military and in the service of our country. Lord, in your mercy. So we continue to pray, Lord, and we ask that you watch over us and guide us. In your name, amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord put his countenance upon you and give you his peace.
Peace and serve the Lord.